السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه ما بعد. جزاكم الله خير for waiting all of this time. I know it's late. Inshallah ta'ala. I'll try to wrap up within 10-15 minutes. Inshallah ta'ala. So, brothers and sisters, as you all know, the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, as Ibn Hazm says, is one of the most important and eternal sources of wisdom. Ibn Hazm writes a beautiful line. He says, if Allah had not given any other miracle to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam than his seerah, that would be enough to prove he was a prophet. And you know, if you look at the story of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, if you look at the story of the seerah, I swear to you, there is no story in human history that is more grand and more epic than the story of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And I mean what I'm saying here. You cannot think of any other story written by man, whether it is the epic of Gilgamesh, whether it is the Iliad of Homer, the Odyssey, no matter what magnificent human story you think of, you cannot think of a story that is more grandiose and more impactful and more real than the story of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Look from where he began as an orphan child, born in impoverished circumstances, and slowly but surely he worked his way up to a level of respectability and love in his own community, to wed a lady who was to become his life partner for the next 25 years. And he would have had a good career and a good relationship with his people. But then he began a new teaching that caused him to be expelled. He had to flee for his life. His own people tried to kill him. So a neighboring city adopts him. And then 3, 4, 5 battles take place until eventually he comes back as the conqueror of the very city that had kicked him out. He forgives them all and they embrace the faith. This new faith now begins to carve out a new identity, not just in Mecca where he was born, not just in Medina where he migrated to, but in the entire Arabian Peninsula. A civilization that was unknown, the Arab civilization, a civilization that was never united, a civilization that did not even have a government, eventually, within 5 years, challenges the two greatest superpowers of their times simultaneously. At the same time, Khalid ibn al-Walid is in one, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas is another. They're taking on Qadisiyah here, Yarmouk over there. They take on the Sassanid Empire. They take on the Byzantine Empire. And a land and a group of peoples that were marginal, that were on the fringe of humanity. They would have just been relegated to a footnote in human history. They rise up from the ashes. They rise up from a civilization that wasn't even respected. And they take on the two superpowers to destroy one of them in its entirety. The Sassanid Empire was completely destroyed within 10 years. It was dissolved even though the Romans had been trying for 300 years to fight the Sassanids and to attack them. For 300 years, the Sassanids, the Persians, proved their might. And here we have a small group of Sahaba take on this mighty empire. Why? Because our Prophet predicted when the ruler of the Persian Empire tore up the letter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, this is Khusro and there shall be no Khusro after him. There will not be any other emperor after him. This will be the last of his line. How could our Prophet have predicted that a dynasty of 300 years, a civilization of 1,000 years would diminish between morning and evening, between a night and a day? Our Prophet said there will be no Khusro after him. And that's exactly what happened. Like they tore my letter up, Allah will tear their kingdom up. And so when our Muslim army came, literally it fizzled up in front of them, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed us with this mighty empire. Not only that, the Byzantine Empire, and one domino after another, within 50 years, the Muslims, the Sahaba's children, had already landed in Europe, and they started a civilization in Andalus, the likes of which human history has never seen. No civilization in history did what Islam did. No prophet did what our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. If you look at the chart of the world before Islam and the chart after Islam, you will see the impact of one human being. And what is even more miraculous, it is true, there were other leaders out there. Alexander the Great conquered quite a lot of the world. Genghis Khan conquered quite a lot of the world. It is true, there were conquerors. It is true. But those other conquerors, they conquered land. They did not conquer hearts. They conquered land, they did not conquer souls. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wherever his name reached, wherever his religion came, it implanted not only in the land and the soil, but more importantly, in the hearts and in the minds of the people. Subhanallah, politics went and came and went, kings came and went, dynasties came and went. Wherever Islam came, the religion stayed and did not leave, except in small pockets where it was physically kicked out, where the Muslims were persecuted, where they were forced to leave. No other history, no other civilization, no other person can claim that level of loyalty that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has. And that is why Allah has said in the Quran, لَقَدْ أَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ كِتَابًا فِيهِ ذِكْرُكُمْ. We have sent down to you a book. In this book shall be your legacy, your dhikr, your remembrance, your civilization, your izzah will be in this religion. This is why Allah says in the Quran, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ. Your dhikr, Ya Rasulullah, we have raised it high up. Your legacy is unparalleled in all of human history. And that is why in the famous book, Michael Hart, the intellectual of two decades ago, a very famous intellectual of two decades ago, when he wrote his book, The Greatest 100, and he wrote a compilation in human history of all of the people who had come and who were the greatest as a non-Muslim agnostic, he began that book with the name of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said, my choice of Muhammad to lead on the list of 100 would be surprising for many, but I cannot think of anyone who has been more successful and impacted humanity more than this one person, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Brothers and sisters, again, so much can be said, and I know you have patiently waited for all of this time. I just want to conclude on some concluding thoughts inshallah ta'ala, and then call it an evening. Realize, my dear brothers and sisters, that the legacy of our Prophet is so great, his impact is so magnificent for many reasons. Of them is that he came with a comprehensive message, a message that interlocks with many facets of our life. He didn't just come as a political leader. He didn't just come as a social worker. He didn't just come with a theology. He didn't just come with laws. He came with everything that we needed to be guided in this world. And that is why if you look at the Prophet ﷺ from the angle of theology, you find all that he came with. If you look at it from the angle of law, you look at the Sharia. If you look at the angle of ethics, you find all of this. If you look at any angle, you find so much to extract from. Now here we are, 14 and a half centuries later, and even specialists amongst us, we cannot master all of his legacy. Who can possibly walk in the footsteps of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam other than he? Nobody can do that. So even us who have taken it on our lives to be full-time academics, full-time callers to Islam, we have to specialize. So some amongst us will become theologians, others will master the Sharia, others will become experts of his hadith and seerah, others will take on aspects of his tarbiyah and teach the people. And that is why throughout our human history, we've always had specialists. There's nothing wrong with that. But I just want to leave us with one thought, and that is that the problem is not specialization. The problem is not that one person is doing what other persons are not. That's fine. That's human nature. But there must be one caveat, and that is, no matter what area that a person wants to get involved with, there must be a holistic connection with other areas as well. Even academics and activists, and this is one of my points I've been talking about for so many years, academics and ulama and mashayikh and activists in the political realm, that's fine that people are different and they have different spheres, but each one needs to benefit from the other, and each one needs to be put into check. and make sure they do not cross red lines that the Sharia and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will not allow them to cross. In the end of the day, brothers and sisters, unfortunately, too many of our scholarly class has become so much entrenched with the books and with the masajid and with the religious folks that it is true to say that some amongst them have lost touch with the greater public. They've lost touch with activism. They've lost touch with social changes. On the flip side, we also have activists who are so much involved with activism, with the issues of today, with the problems of the hour, that at times they lose touch with our tradition, with our books, with our morals, with our values. Both of these are mistakes. Both of these are extremisms. Each side has to benefit from the other. And I've been saying this for a number of years now. Academics need to understand there is a role for political activism. An activist needs to understand their activism also needs to be influenced by the theology and the ethics of Islam. In the end of the day, each one needs the other. And Islam was only successful because it was holistic, because it had a whole program in place. And to conclude, I'll give you two simple examples and then we'll call it a day. My dear brothers and sisters, an alim, a sheikh, an academic is only as good as how effective he is. Similarly, a political activist is only as good as the impact they cause. But Islam teaches us that faith and actions, they go hand in hand. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ Iman and amal are paired together 70 times in the Quran. You cannot and you should not have one without the other. Let's look at two simple examples that Islam came to solve, and then inshallah we'll call it a day or an evening for tonight. Two simple examples. The first of them, racism. Racism. Islam takes on racism. Of course it takes it on. One of the first teachings of Islam, one of the teachings that made it unpopular, was our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam began preaching in early Mecca, by the way, even before Salah had been revealed, even before Zakah had been legislated. In early Mecca, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam began preaching that all mankind is equal. And that is why Bilal and Ibn Mas'ud and others were attracted to Islam. They saw in it human dignity. They saw in it, we are all equal in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why Safwan ibn Umayyah and others of the leaders of the Quraysh, Walid ibn al-Mughira and Umayyah ibn Khalaf, they came to Abu Talib and they said to him, does your nephew think that we and our slaves are equal? How foolish is he? This is in the books of Sirah in early Mecca. Does your nephew preach that we and our slaves are equal? What religion is he preaching? So taking on anti-racism is something that is in early Islam, but it was linked directly to theology and iman and aqidah. You cannot resolve the sin of racism without also talking about theology. Ya ayyuha an-nas inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qaba'ila lita'arafu kullukum min adam wa adamu min turab. You have to bring in the theology and you link it with the reality of the fact that racial equality is something that is a political and religious necessity. You cannot have one without the other. Fact of the matter is, if you really and truly don't believe in Allah, there is no mechanism to keep your ethics and morality in check. And this is, by the way, called the moral argument for the existence of God. And it is an Islamic argument. Without God, there can be no ultimate morality. There is no ultimate right and wrong. You need to bring God into the picture. And so activists and ulama need to understand they must work hand in hand. The second simple example, and that will be the final one for tonight, it is the one that deals with the ethical sins that people do, the excesses of lust and gluttony and greed. And I can give many examples, whether it is interest, whether it is whatnot, but the most obvious one that comes to mind is that of drinking alcohol. You all know, dear brothers and sisters, that 100 years ago, literally 100 years ago, it's 2019 now, 1919, 100 years ago, this country tried its best to ban alcohol. The 19th Amendment was passed. They prohibited the sale, the transportation, and the drinking of alcohol. You and I both know, you've gone through American history, what a dismal, abysmal failure that was. A failure of the highest magnitude, such that barely 2-3 years later, they had to embarrassingly admit to the world, didn't work, let's cancel that constitutional law, let's repeal it, let's appeal it, let's amend it. And so the Constitution was amended because they failed to implement one simple law, and that is don't drink. You're never, ever going to successfully tackle society's moral problems without linking them to iman and taqwa. And that is why when Allah revealed in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِّنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. In the third year of the Hijrah, in the city of Medina, when Allah revealed that khamr is filthy and khamr is a najis and a rijis, get rid of it if you want to be successful, then they didn't need to pass the 19th Amendment. They didn't need to have a federal arms and a bureau to go tackle. They didn't need to take on the Al Capone industry. They didn't need to do anything other than recite the verse out loud. That's all the Muslims needed to hear. And as we all know, and the books of Sirah and Hadith both mention this, that as soon as the Sahaba heard that verse, they had the cup of wine in their lips and they took it out and they threw it out the window. The streets of Medina flowed with the smell of wine for 3 days because everybody got rid of wine on their own. You cannot tackle society's problems without linking it to faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Islam is a package deal. Our ulama need to understand that Islam is more than just advanced halaqat to the 10 students of knowledge that come to their masajid. Agreed. But so too, our activists need to understand that Islam's ethics and morality, Islam's issues of vice and virtue, it is linked with this tradition. We don't just simply follow the flavor of the month. What is politically correct becomes Islamic. What is politically incorrect becomes un-Islamic. No, we have a tradition, we have a text, we have a methodology, we have an ideology. That's who we are. It's not the culture around us that dictates right and wrong. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلْ لَا يَسْتَوِي الْخَبِيثُ وَالطَّيِّبُ وَلَوْ أَعْجَبَكَ كَثْرَةُ الْخَبِيثُ. Say, good and evil are not the same, even if the preponderance of the evil bedazzles you. Even if you're confused that everybody seems to be legitimizing an evil, everybody seems to be endorsing an evil, it does not change the fact that evil is evil and good is good. We need to link our activism with our tradition, and our traditionalists also need to understand that Islam is an activist faith tradition. So the bottom line, brothers and sisters, yes indeed, let's all specialize. Everyone should go and do something they like, whether it is advanced Islamic knowledge, whether it is campaigning for something that society needs. But whatever we are doing, we need to do it under the rubric of Islam. We need to do it under the umbrella of the tradition of Islam. We need to do it in light of the guidance of the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We need to be very, very, very careful about projecting an imaginary version of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam into our minds and then saying he would have done that, he would have said that. We don't need to imagine what he would have done. We have the seerah, we have the books of hadith, we have his entire methodology, and that is why Allah Azza wa Jal commands us in the Quran, O you who believe, if you differ about anything, take it back to Allah and his messenger. As the Sahaba said, this means you take it back to the Quran in light of the seerah, in light of the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forever cause us to walk in the footsteps of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase our love for the Quran and our love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who establish the salah, pray the zakah, pay the zakah, avoid the major sins, and spread the love and peace of Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow our friends, our colleagues, our neighbors, the people around us to see in our actions the glimmer of beauty of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We seek refuge in Allah from making Islam look bad through our actions. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us to be of those who become role models and ambassadors of our faith. We pray, O Allah, we pray to you that if for a wisdom that you know, you have deprived deprived us from being in the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this world. We beg and we pray to you, O Allah, that you do not deprive us of his presence on judgment day, that we are resurrected with him on judgment day, that we drink from his fountain with his personal invitation on judgment day, that we are granted his shafa'ah on judgment day, that we enter Jannah with him and with the righteous, and that we are in Jannatul Firdaus A'la along with him and the companions. And what a noble companionship they are. Wa jazakumullahu khayran. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.